I am here with Dr. Ronald Graybill, someone who I am very privileged to interview with. Dr. Graybill, as we will get into, really I consider him and his work foundational for Black Adventist history, and I will justify that statement. But his two works, his two 1970 E.G. White and Church Race Relations, and then 1971 Mission to Black America, I consider in many ways to have created something of a foundation, not only for Black Adventist historiography, but really I think in many ways those works and some of his later projects helped modernize Adventist historiography writ large, Adventist historiography in general. And so we're going to talk about, and besides that, on a different level, he's always been an interesting historian. I mean, just all of his articles and his pursuits, from his early articles in Insight, I think back then it may have been Youth Instructor. No, it was probably Insight, to his time as editor of the Columbia Union Visitor, to all the way up to his recent discovery of an Ellen White photo. I think this is 2014, 15, 16? When was that?
I forget the date, and that grew out of my centennial book on the history of the White Memorial Medical Center in Los Angeles. Okay. One of the doctors that trained at that very early clinic in 1913, his daughter, not a Seventh-day Adventist at all, she was going through his papers. I had interviewed her. And she found this picture and she said, Dr. Graybill, I don't know who this is, but it may be your founder, Ellen White. Could you come and see this, you know? Yes. And sure enough, it was. So that was an interesting discovery.
Well, there is, I've often thought, believe it or not, and maybe I should use my mind for better things, but I've often thought what a discovery is. Because when you discover a photo, obviously someone took the photo and someone knew about the photo all along, because people were looking at it, but then there is a lull, there's a period where no one sees it, or it kind of goes out of a collective memory. And then it's rediscovered by the right person or enough people. And so we call that a discovery.
It was there all along.
But it was wonderful, because I think, is that the only photo in which she was wearing a hat?
I think we have pictures of her with a bonnet on, but I think it's only one where she's wearing a hat. And my word, her daughter-in-law had an even fancier hat on, so.
Yeah,
it's one of those photos that shows that she didn't entirely remain totally straight-laced about things. She changed with the times.
Sure, and she has on pince-nez glasses.
Well, no, I don't recall that. Maybe you have it in your slides. I don't know. We'll see.
Or maybe I'm thinking of Willie, but I think that she's wearing the little small pince-nezes. I think. But anyhow, that was an amazing discovery, because there was an Adventist Review article that accompanied it. And it let a lot of us know, because I was working at the GC archives then, it let us a lot of us know that there were still discoveries to make.
Yeah, there's still things to be found.
Even this late in the game, and I think either shortly before then or shortly afterwards, the White Estate released all of her unpublished writings. That was in 2015.
They released the edited copies of all of her unpublished writings. I say it that way very carefully, because I just, my almost my most recent book was a book called Visions and Revisions, A Textual History of Ellen White's Writings, in which I argue that there are things to be learned from looking at the handwritten originals of Ellen White's letters and diaries that are lost in the process of polishing them and putting them into proper grammar and so on and preparing them for publication. So I'm always just careful to say, well, they published all of the edited versions of her letters and diaries. And that's been a great, great help. Oh my goodness. I mean, we can now find in her letters and manuscripts things that would have taken us many hours, if not days, weeks, and months and years to find if we had to sit down with the paper copies and just read through, because it's all searchable. It's all searchable.
Yeah, and that's the benefit of typing them, actually transcribing them, because you can search them.
Yeah, you can search them. Not only was that a courageous thing. Well, you know, in terms of our background, we knew the days when the White Estate was reluctant to release anything. You know, but they have actually put online a number of the books from which Mrs. White borrowed material. James Wiley's History of the Reformation and some of the books on the life of Christ that she borrowed from in Desire of Ages and other places. So the church is comfortable enough with that and has a firm enough understanding and explanation of how that works that they just put them on there. You can find those things. You know,
we were anticipating, I think, when with the centenary of her death, and when they released her all of her writings, at least as you say, the edited versions of them in 2015, we were anticipating all sorts of new offspring, offshoot groups to come up, you know, and all sorts of Trinitarian movements and all that stuff. But I don't think that it panned out like we thought. We were like, what's going to happen with all these writings out? But I haven't really seen much.
Well, you and I don't look for it much, but once in a while, when I stumble onto it, I don't know that they've greatly increased their attacks and criticisms on the basis of these new releases, but there's plenty of stuff out there. There's plenty of stuff out there.
Yeah. So let's sort of get into your odyssey, because really this is a good way to start our discussion, because you were there. You saw so much of the evolution, if you know, for lack of a better word, the evolution of the White Estate, because you worked closely with Arthur White on his 6-volume biography. You were there for so much of it. And so for you to see and speak on this culmination, just to say a little bit of an introduction, because we just kind of jumped into it, Dr. Ronald Graybill has served the church as a university professor, a pastor, an editor, a researcher, you name it. And we're going to get into his career, so I'm not going to give that much of an introduction. But Doc, if you can just tell us where you were born, how you came about doing Adventist history, and then we'll get into the Black Adventist history piece.
Well, my interest in history started here at Sutter's Fort in Sacramento. My parents had divorced. I spent some months with my father in Sacramento, and he took me to Sutter's Fort, and I was fascinated by that. But my interest in Black Adventist history, let me say, my interest in race relations then was inspired by the reaction to my high school girlfriend. I dated a girl. In fact, I was, I would say, pathologically in love with this girl, obsessively. And but anyway, my aunt, this girl was part Mexican, part Apache Indian, and part French. Okay, my aunt thought this was terrible that I would be dating a Mexican. Oh my goodness, she said, she will grow up and be fat, and you will. Oh, I'm good. And I thought this was so grossly unfair that I immediately started to understand what racism was about, why it was unfair. And then, if we go into your slide program, I think we can see more of the things that I wrote and tell more of that story.
Yes, very quickly. So this was, you were dating this girl in the 1960s, and this was in California.
Yes, 1960, 61, yes, yeah.
Right, and you, your childhood was in California. You
grew up in Northern California. I had cousins that had gone to Newbury Park Academy down in Southern California, and so my mother sent me there to get my high school education, and that's where these events occurred.
Okay, and so this is where, when your father took you to Sutter's Fort, you first started becoming interested in history, in doing history.
Yes, I did. I began to be interested in history. And then he also would take me to the Crocker Art Gallery there in Sacramento. And so I got interested in art too. Years later, when I was working at the Ellen White Estate, which was at that point in Washington, D.C., we would take our daughter to the National Gallery of Art. And she got inspired, and she's now an art history professor at the University of Utah.
Yes.
Yeah, so it all goes back to some roots, you know.
Now tell me this, what were your, if we're talking the 1960s, quite a time in American history, something like the time I think we're living in now, with some of the upheavals, at least in the late 60s, with some of the upheavals and the tumult that is occurring now, what were some of your intellectual influences? Because one thing that I believe about your historiography is that you brought a different intellectual caliber into Adventist historiography, and you, along with Jonathan Butler, Ronald Numbers, and others, you sort of modernized Adventist historiography. I think
to some degree, there may have been others who were starting to do that too, but I think to some degree what we were trying to do is to relate what was happening inside the church with what was happening outside the church, and to give the larger cultural and historical setting for that. Now, during my college days at La Sierra, what is now La Sierra University, of course, we were watching television about the civil rights movement, and we were being, I don't remember a lot of my professors that were, you know, they were, many of them were liberals, and they were as outraged as I was, but there wasn't a lot going on in the classroom to inspire me to pursue the history of race relations. But when I got to the seminary, and that story will come out when you start showing the book.
Okay, let's look at this PowerPoint that I have here. And I just want to set up a few things. Before E.G. White and church race relations, which is what Dr. Graybill produced in 1970, there really was not a monograph. There really was not a single book published devoted to Adventist history and race before that. I think that I can say that and have a good amount of accuracy. Now, as you will see here, and Doc, I'm really speaking to the listeners also, so I'm not trying to lecture you. I'm speaking to the reader, to the listeners. There was lights and shades in the black belt, and this was prepared by Arthur Spalding, who of course is one of Adventism's most prolific authors. And this was he did this from 1914 to 1916, but it was never published. And so it's available in manuscript form on blacksdahistory.org, on adventistarchives.org, and I don't think it's available on the Ellen G. White estate site.
I don't know about that. I must confess that a lot of the factual material that I used in Mission to Black America was gleaned from that work. But because Spalding, and I also think that Ellen White's lead secretary, Clarence Crisler, was very much involved, and there's correspondence between the two of them on that, very much involved in this. But Spalding or Crisler tended to consult for, and this book had some historical background in it too, and other, you know, what was going on in the culture. But they tended to consult sources to get the context, sources that reflected a kind of benign, or let's say paternalistic racism, the Southern sources, you see. And I don't know if I ever really proved this, but I got the distinct impression that after the manuscript was completed and they began to circulate it with some of the pioneer black ministers in the South, that the reaction they got was so pronounced, the negative reaction they got was so pronounced that they it never was published. And during the 60s, I thought, well, that's a good thing. Now we can understand this sort of thing better now than we did then. I mean, we're in an era when we can understand that in some small ways, Abraham Lincoln was a racist, you know what I mean? But we have, before we tear down a statue, we need to look and see, well, what is the overall, what is the major influence of this person's life, and so on. So John Muir, the great naturalist, you know, apparently expressed some racist views. I haven't studied that. But most of his life and most of his influence was devoted to helping us to preserve and understand and appreciate nature. So we all have our flaws, and these people had their flaws, and historians of the past had their flaws. We have our own. We'll be corrected by the next generation.
Sure. And that's some of the self-righteousness and maybe even narcissism of our age, that we are so judgmental of those in the past, and it's really presentist. We're judging them by our present standards.
Yeah.
And we're applying it to the past, but people could look back at us, let's say 100 years, and see huge gaps in our own, you know, between our own behavior and integrity and morality and fairness. So I think that, wouldn't you say that Spalding and perhaps Ellen White were on the Booker T. Washington side of the Du Bois Washington debate?
That's right. And what was the original name of Oakwood?
Yeah.
Wasn't it called industrial and agricultural?
Sure.
You know, they weren't training PhDs in science.
Yeah, and this is one thing that we'll talk about with your book, E.G. White and Church-Race Relations, because you bring that out. You call it the Age of Washington, or I think that was Rayford Logan. But the age of Booker T. Washington is the 1895 to 1915. And this, incidentally, is really when Ellen White wrote the most about the black work during that, during those 20 years. And both Ellen White and Booker T. Washington both died in 1915.
There you go.
And yeah. I like how in E.G. White and Church Race Relations, you frame her, you contextualize Ellen White in within the ideology of Booker T. Washington. And Dr. Graybill, to be quite frank, because as you know, every generation, the Ellen White is racist idea pops up in new forms, and it's all over the internet now. And I think that a lot of that comes from not people not understanding Ellen White, but people not understanding Booker T. Washington. With his Atlanta Exposition speech shortly after Plessy versus Ferguson. I'm trying to remember if it was before or after Plessy versus Ferguson, but he was saying, we can stay separate. Blacks can stay separate and build ourselves up, you know, this uplift suasion and really learn the skills apart from whites. So separation is fine. And I think in many ways, Ellen White agreed with that, especially when what was going on with Edson and the Southern Missionary Society in Mississippi.
Yeah, and what happened in Washington, D.C. and Nashville, things that were pointed out in Doug Morgan's book about Louis Schieff, you know.
Yeah.
Well, okay, let's go on then.
Okay. And in 1932, there was H.D. Singleton's, he did a short history, and then O.B. Edwards in 1942, 10 years later, Origin and Development of the SDA work, and that was mainly in Alabama, Mississippi. So I'm just giving a little bit of...
I didn't even know that. Yeah, that's good.
Then, of course, in 66, you had the encyclopedia, and then the second volume, actually in the 76 volume, I think it was still a single volume. This is the 1996. And have you ever seen this book, Doc, from So Small a Dream?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Yes, this was 1968.
Ah.
1968. Now, there were articles and manuscripts on Black Adventist history, especially in the North American Informant, which was the predecessor to the Regional Voice. Okay. And they were doing a lot of documenting. In fact, it's very interesting, some of the things they said about William Foy in, let's say, 1965, Frank L. Peterson was writing a history of Adventism and the Black contribution to Adventism. And in 1965, he said, William Foy had visions from God and he shared them. So it was rather progressive. And so they understood a lot of the early Black Adventist heritage that I think was forgotten for a little while, and now it's being resuscitated. Okay, so you come along in 1970, and this is, I think that your book, E.G. White and Church Race Relations, went beyond the old apologetics. I think it was more than that. It was a lot more sophisticated than that. And as you say, it was a contextualization. So please, Doc, just walk us through how you came about writing this.
Well, you know, these were the days when Adventists were, in higher education, Adventists were anxious to get their schools accredited. And a lot of... young Adventists had been sent off to different universities to get their degrees, and Roy Branson came to the seminary with a degree in ethics from Harvard University. And I don't even remember, it was an ethics course where Branson said, you know, we need to understand the background of Ellen White's statements about race relations. And a book that you might find interesting is C. Van Woodward's book. My word, I can't even remember the title.
Strange Career of Jim Crow?
Well, The Strange Career of Jim Crow. And when I read that book and I discovered that early on when Mrs. White made those very progressive statements in the Southern Work, things were possible and happening in the South at that time that became virtually impossible as Jim Crow laws fastened themselves ever more tightly on the South. And so that was kind of the background of the book, Ellen G. White and Church Race Relations, because I wanted to show that there was an explanation for the change from Southern Work to the Testimonies in Volume 9, you know, in 1909. Now, I've argued since then that when Ellen White made that statement in her handwriting about blacks and whites mingling in social equality, she never used the term social equality. Social equality was a code word, a much maligned code word for, on the part of the Southern whites, for integration. And integration to them meant intermarriage, for pity's sake. What she wrote was, she didn't say social equality, she said free and easy association. So she was describing a type of relationship. She was not saying anything about equality. But Clarence Crisler, again, a Floridian, and he inserted the word. Now, Ellen White is responsible for it because he gave the typescript back to her and she approved it. She may not have realized how loaded that word was, or at least how loaded it seemed to me in the 1960s and still does, and so on. So I think, you know, both looking at the context of the times and looking at what Ellen White actually wrote helps us to understand her and see where and how she helped advance the cause of social justice in our church, even as she had some shortcomings in terms of her expressions and her understanding. Now, so that book came out, and it was so helpful that it helped me get my job at the White Estate to help Arthur White work on the biography of Ellen White. And I had immediately moved on from that book to the next one that you're going to show there on your slides.
Now, Doc, real quick, let me ask you, where were you working in 1970?
In 1970, yes, I was working in, let me tell you too, that's a couple of interesting stories. This interview may not get as far along as you had hoped in 1 hour. But anyway, I first went from the seminary, I went to Ukiah, California. And I immediately, knowing I was going there, I immediately ordered the local newspaper. And there I saw a wonderful story about this pastor in nearby Redwood City who had adopted black children and a very liberal, progressive fellow. And I thought, well, that's interesting. I'm going to have to look into that. Well, when I got there, the Adventist pastor told me, the pastor that was I was reading about was Jim Jones. And the Adventist pastor was telling me, boy, you better be careful about him. I hear some things that are not too savory. That was even in his Ukiah days. But I got involved in the local ministerial fellowship, and I was invited to speak in the ecumenical Easter service. And when I got there, I discovered that Jim Jones was going to be speaking too, and he was going to speak right after me. I had chosen to read a short story by Paul Claudel called The Death of Judas. And this story was sort of told from Judas's point of view, how he was most the best educated, and he was so much better than all these other disciples, and so on and so forth. And so Judas was defending himself And at the end of the story, it says, you know, consider the tree. He's talking about the tree where he hung himself, you know. Oh, the branches go off in all directions, unlike the cross, which is brutally cut off against the sky, and then so on and so forth. So I read this, and everybody is realizing how deluded, you know, Judas was. Jim Jones gets up right after me, and he says, this story has so shaken me that I'm throwing away everything I was going to say. I don't remember what he ended up saying, but later I thought, you know, if he thought about it, he would have realized there was a lot of the Judas thinking in his mind. So anyway, from Ukiah, I was transferred to East Oakland, and I was working on that other book about Mission to Black America, and E.E. Cleveland, our famous evangelist, came to town, and I was the straight man in his during his evangelistic meetings. The audience would turn in questions, and I, as this smart aleck white guy, would ask E.E. Cleveland these questions in a voice that sort of implied that I'm sure he couldn't answer this tough one, you know. And then he would just, you know, he was so eloquent and so used to these questions, and he did so well. So that was very humorous. People enjoyed it. And then I wrote an article.
Ron, real quick. Sorry, Ron. You were a pastor in the area, and E.E. Cleveland came to town to do a evangelistic campaign?
That's right.
And so you were helping him with it?
I was helping him. I helped with the advertising, and I helped with the meetings, you know. And then I wrote a story in Insight magazine called Black and White Together, you know, about that multiracial evangelistic campaign. And from there, we, you know, my son was born, and we went back to Washington and started helping Arthur White on the biography of Ellen White.
Okay, well, that must have been when you kind of developed a friendship with Elder Cleveland, because he wrote the preface to this book.
Oh, to Church Race Relations?
Yes.
Oh, I had forgotten that, and I didn't even look in it today when I made a picture of it. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. No, yeah. We were friends for life from that point.
Okay. What was so you said that the reception of this was good. Just going into this book, when you started writing it, did you have like your apologetic hat on? Or were you like, did you want to exonerate Ellen White from some claims that she, or some accusations that she was racist?
Well, yes, I was an apologist and so on, but I was an apologist who was trying to use evidence from the time to correct what I felt was a misapprehension of who she was and where she was and what she really meant, and why her statements seemed to change from Southern Work to Volume 9. And the book was a great relief to the church, because you know, it was, the church had suffered from a misapprehension of Ellen White and race relations, and so this helped in some degree to correct that view.
And it helped you, so you said that it helped you get a job in the white estate. And did it also sort of launch a lecture career for you?
Well, you know, when I was at the white estate, I did a lot of traveling and lecturing, but I don't remember much about that or the reactions to it. I really don't. That's strange, but I don't.
Okay, because I have some, or I had some of your old tapes of your lectures on different, I wish I still had them so that I could digitize them and make them available. But I remember one when you were at Pine Forge Academy, and you were lecturing on Edson White and his work in Mississippi. So I remember that one in particular, but yeah. I would listen to some of those growing up. Okay, Mission to Black America, the next year, you came out with this. Please talk to us about this, your research, and why you wrote it.
Well, you know, Edson White had a hard time as a child and all through his life. He had weaknesses, he had personality defects, and so on. But this was his one greatest achievement. Well, he wrote some books that were very successful sellers by Adventist literature evangelists. But he's remembered most for pioneering the work in Mississippi and calling the churches. I mean, there were black workers before that, and there were work going on, but this really brought the work among black people to the attention of the larger church. And so I was able to use lights and shades to get the research and reaction that Spalding and Chrysler had collected, and put this book together, and was able to travel to Mississippi, which was a great, which I really, really enjoyed, and taking pictures and meeting some of the descendants of some of the people that caused trouble for Edson. Now, I must say, while we're on this book, you probably don't have a picture of it, but with the help of Oak and Acorn, Mission to Black America has been reprinted, and it's available now on Amazon in hard copy and as a Kindle book.
Yes, I will be sure to put that link in the video below. And we see it, it's right behind your head, so.
Yeah. I made a few changes, passage of time required me to make a few changes. And I corrected one. I had always imagined that the star from the Morning Star, I imagined a big brass metal star shining. Well, no, it was a wooden star. It's still at the museum at Oakwood University. But I made a few corrections, but the book is very much the same as it was back in 71.
And by 71, you were working at the White Estate?
Well, I think by the end of that year, I was there. Yes. I was working at the White Estate. I started out by touring around California, visiting and interviewing some old timers who had known Ellen White in her later years. And that's the reason why Arthur White and I published the last volume of his biography first, the Elmshaven years. We published that volume first.
That was volume 6, and it came first.
Yeah, it actually came first.
Yeah. Yeah, sort of counterintuitive there.
Yeah.
All right, this article came from your trips to Mississippi, I suppose, Vicksburg, Lintonia, Yazoo City, all of those?
Yes, and that's where I met the right near this, it shows me here at Bruce's Landing, but right near Bruce's Landing is where the Ball Ground Plantation was located, from whence the mob descended on the school and burned the books and charts and maps. They didn't burn the school, but they burned everything out of it and warned them to stay away. And they also formed the party that whipped Nate Alden. And the descendant, the grandson of the man who led those raids, he said, and if I can use his language, "You couldn't get a nigger to work on Saturday around here," because these black people had become Seventh-day Adventists. And so it was an economic threat to them. So they wanted to warn one of the Seventh-day Adventist believers that they shouldn't follow these folks. And then, of course, as you know, later on, the Yazoo City newspaper came out with some very virulent accusations that made life very dangerous for some.
Really, mainly against Fred Rogers, right?
That against Rogers, and it was, it was really that situation where Ellen White, Edson White, and others realized that we could not, in this racial climate, we could not expect to foster the work among African Americans by sending white missionaries in. We needed workers trained at Oakwood that could come in and work safely in those situations. And so Edson's experience and the violence that he and his workers suffered, or the threats of violence that they suffered, helped urge on and helped the church realize the necessity of really getting Oakwood started and getting it going and training black workers.
And we can say that the Nate Olvin situation was really the closing of the South that you wrote about in E.G. White and Church, Race, Relations. In fact, you have a whole chapter on that. But essentially, just for our viewers, Ellen White and some other Adventists at the time were saying that the South was going to close. The South was going to close. And that was like a looming missiological threat, if you will, if Adventists flouted the color line mores. You know, they call it color line. That was maybe Jim Crow segregation. And so if they flouted it, or if they were perceived as violating it, Adventists believe that white supremacists, white terrorists, and in some cases blacks as well, would push them out, and they couldn't do evangelism there. So that was called the closing of the South. And really, would you say that's why Edson, at least Edson's part of the Southern Missionary Society, ended up leaving and going to Nashville?
Oh yes. And you mentioned black opposition. Of course, the black Baptist ministers, they were opposed to Seventh-day Adventists, just like white Baptist ministers were in the North. And in a few cases, I don't know, but in a few cases, some of these black Baptist ministers, I think, inflamed white opposition by claiming that Rogers was practicing social equality and that he had adopted these black teenage girls and treated them as equal to his own, equal members of his own family. So there was opposition in both ways, but of course the white opposition was much more dangerous. Now, I think, I hope I'm remembering this right, that when I got ready to republish Mission to Black America, I studied further about the future of Nate Olvin, because back in the day when I did this work, before all the Adventist publications were online and you could search for them, I knew that Nate Olvin had been sent to the Mississippi State Penitentiary, which was often a death sentence, no matter what the length of the sentence was. They were practicing the convict lease system, you know, and everything. But Olvin actually did survive the penitentiary. He was, by the way, he was wrongly convicted of child abuse. And he did survive the prison experience, and later he became an Adventist call porter. I think I'm remembering. You know, I'm an old man myself now, and I can't remember everything.
Tell us this. What was it like? I know that we have to move on, but what was it like for you to go to Mississippi, to these historic spots, historic not only in Adventism, but of course Vicksburg is one of the major, you know, war battles of the Civil War. What was it like? How did you reconstruct this, for lack of a better term? How did you unearth what happened in the 1890s?
Well, I generally didn't tell them specifically what I was about and what I was working on and so on. I was just interested in the local history, and I knew that there had been stories in the Yazoo City Sentinel, the newspaper, And I discovered that the, I don't remember what was the library or the newspaper office in Yazoo City still had copies of those old papers. And so they let me look at them. And I didn't mention what I was particularly looking for. And I had my camera with me and I took pictures of the newspaper articles. And then I visited the mansion of the owner of the Ball Ground Plantation in Vicksburg, just like any other tourist, you know. And I saw the cannonball lodged in the wall that General Grant's gunboats had lobbed through the front, lobbed through the window into that house. So I just I just was a normal historian looking into local history.
Yeah. Okay. Moving on very quickly. Tell us about this. This is a very important and foundational article. Before that, there had been brief biographical pieces on Charles Kinney, but this was an actual historian writing on Charles Kinney, and you termed him the founder of Black Adventism, and that was sort of a reflection of what was already being said, but that title also stuck. So can you tell us how you got interested in Kinney and how you wrote this?
Well, you know, after I read about Black ministers in the South opposing lights and shades in the Black Belt, I got interested in them. And when I was at the General Conference, I discovered that Kinney was actually, I think Kinney was actually paid by the General Conference. So he had to turn in weekly or monthly reports about his activity. And so was able in the archives to consult his letters and his workers' reports and get some more background. Now, of course, in the years that have passed, you and others have been able to learn a good deal more about Black, about Charles Kinney and about other Adventists other Black Adventists who were ministers who were active in this period of time. But it was a real thrill to me to learn new things about this pioneer minister.
And it's still a very good one thing, and this is the deepest compliment I think that one historian can give another, is that your work has stood the test of time. I still read E.G. White and Church Race Relations and think this is fantastic. I still learn it. No, I mean really, I still learn and am edified by it. So this, when you wrote this, the archives was established, you know, F. Donald Yost. You know, we're talking 74, 75.
Yeah.
So he was really just starting the archives, and you were you right next, where was it then? Because this is in Tacoma Park, Washington, D.C.
Yeah.
Were they next to each other?
Well, early on, my initial research was just to go into the, I guess it was a vault. It was not, didn't have a huge door on it, but there was a basement room that had all these General Conference records in it. And I got into that and dug up some of these records. And then after Don Yost started getting things organized, that helped it as well. But I must say, Benjamin, that you are more familiar with Ellen White and Church Race Relations than I am at this point, because when you mentioned things, I think, oh yeah, I did write about that. so that's good.
One thing also that I appreciate about this article is that you're drawing on primary sources, basically Kinney and Jones.
Yeah.
And just the fact that they were corresponding like that, because Jones was the GC secretary.
Yeah.
And just the fact that they were corresponding like that shows that at that time, Kinney was the point man for Black Adventism.
Yeah.
And so this complements your work on Edson and Ellen White, because Kinney sort of, you know, Kinney definitely predated Edson.
Sure.
But he was like a different strain, you know, of the work. Okay. by this time you were a year before you're getting your PhD from Johns Hopkins.
Yes.
And you wrote for the Adventist Heritage. You were an assistant editor for the Adventist Heritage Journal, which is, to me, is way underrated. Many of the things that you guys wrote about back then and the articles that you did are still, it's like, you know, you read them and you're like, man, this was mighty, mighty enlightened for the 70s and 80s, especially with the layout of Adventist Heritage, beautifully laid out. So you wrote this in 1982. Mrs. White's features it, and this is called, what is it, Leaves from the Ellen White Album, or something to that effect. This is the name of the art, and you can, our listeners can also get this on AdventistArchive.org website. It says, Mrs. White's features often raise the question of whether she had any Black or Indian ancestry. The limited genealogical research, which has been done on both her father's and mother's side of the family, has not shown any such ancestry. The ambiguousness of her features, however, have enabled people of all races and nations to identify with her as a person and as God's messenger. Let me ask you this. There had already been some agitation, if you will, on the question of if Ellen White was Black. I think E.E. Cleveland first wrote about it. Well, he questioned the White estate about it in 1977. And he said, Arthur White responded, said, we can't find anything. And then Cleveland wrote back a rejoinder, and he says rather dramatically in Let the Church Roll On, Arthur White never responded. And so that lack of a second response apparently said that there was something there. What did you encounter about Ellen White's race and in some of your touring about Blacks asking about that? What did you encounter back then? Because you actually wrote about it here.
Yeah. And it's interesting. The White Estate paid for it, but I searched out and hired a Mormon genealogist. You know, you can hire very, very skilled and highly trained genealogists through the Mormon Church. And this woman looked in all directions in Ellen White's family tree and didn't find any documentary evidence of Black ancestry. And I think the White Estate has done that once again later on after, who was the president of the South Central? After the book came out about Ellen White.
Well, Charles Dudley.
Charles Dudley, yeah, after his book. And similarly found that. But two things I want to say about that. First of all, just because there is no record, written record, does not mean that Ellen White had no Black ancestry. I like to tell a fanciful story. This is a totally made-up story, imaginary story, but this is a story about why it is that Ellen White might have had Black ancestry. Robert Harmon was a hatter, and he would work during the cold Maine winters on his hats, and during the spring and summer, he'd go out to Gorham and work on the farm. But work all winter on his hats, and when the ice began to thaw.
Very quickly, Doc, sorry, just to let the listeners know, Robert Harmon was Ellen White's father.
That's right. That's
okay.
Right.
Okay. Sorry to interrupt you.
Yeah. No. She took her mother's birth name, Gould, as her own middle name, which is interesting. But anyway, her father, as soon as the ice would thaw in the harbor, he would put his hats that he had made during the winter into big bags, and he would sail down to the south, because south being more temperate, they were able to farm all winter long, and so hats could sell at a much better premium in the south. So Robert Harmon comes to this, now remember, this is totally fanciful, but he comes to this big plantation, and he's talking to the owner. And while he's talking, in comes a lovely young maiden who appears almost perfectly white. And the plantation owner, let's give him a name, Mason. Okay, and so Colonel Mason, let's call him, you know. He says to Robert Harmon, "Did you see that young, did you see my daughter that just came in?" "Yes." "Do you think she's an attractive young woman?" "Well, why, yes. You know, she presents a problem for me, because many of the people around here know that her mother was one of my slaves. And it's going to be very hard for me to get her married off here in the South. But Robert, she's a wonderful, talented, intelligent, skilled cook, and a wonderful young woman. Why don't you take her up north and marry her, and you will solve my problem, and you'll have a good wife." And so Robert Harmon did, and that's how Ellen Harmon ended up with black ancestry.
Well, there's no picture of her mother, right?
I don't think there is a picture of her mother.
That's the problem. There's not a picture of her mother. And so people fill in those sorts of blanks.
I know. But nobody has gone quite as far as I went. But
well,
anyway.
But Doc, when Ellen White's face was busted, when she was 9 years old, she was hit by a stone.
Yes.
And her father came back from Georgia, right?
Yeah.
He came back from Georgia and he didn't recognize her. That's the legendary story. So he was constantly going down south, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so, but back then, did you get a lot of requests as a researcher at the White Estate to look, I mean, were a lot of people writing to you asking if she was black?
Well, the question would come up during my lectures around the country, and people would write, and yes, and then that was the reason why we hired this Mormon genealogist to look into it, and so on. But my final word on the topic is what you just read there, that apparently the Lord chose one whose features were sufficiently ambiguous that people of any nation could identify with her. And by the way, I have had plastic and facial reconstructive surgeons look at her pictures. They don't think the damage to her nose with the stone created much of a lasting change in her appearance.
Okay, and hopefully we can get some DNA studies done.
Well, you know, I thought about that too, but you know, Charlie White is still alive and he's a great grandson. But if his DNA indicated some black ancestry, we don't know but what it came from some other branch of his ancestry.
Sure.
I suppose if we exhumed Ellen White and we could find DNA, we'll never do it. Anyway, here's the dissertation.
Yes. And then tell me this. What part did you play in The Unknown Prophet? You know, my father's 1987 book, because did you help with the research?
Oh, yes. I didn't do much of the research, but what happened was somehow he was working on the topic. Let's forewarn the listeners that your father wrote the book on William Foy, The Unknown Prophet.
Yes.
And he was working on that, and I was interested in the topic too. And I remember just how it happened, but somehow I discovered that William Foy had been living up in northern Maine, and and that he was buried in this particular cemetery, or that I don't even know if I knew that, but I found out where he was living, and I saw that there was a cemetery nearby. And I called a pastor in the nearest Adventist church, and I said, could you possibly go over there on a Sabbath afternoon and see if you can find a grave for William Foy? And no, it wasn't a pastor. It was a church member. And I said, by the way, brother, what is your occupation? He said, I am an undertaker. Well, I said, that's perfect. He said, I do go over to that cemetery from time to time, and I'll go check. So he went and checked, and he found the grave. And I was so excited, and I called your father, and I couldn't quite tell whether your father was, your father was partly delighted and thrilled that it had been found, and disappointed that he hadn't found it first. But anyway, together we rehabilitated William Foy, and part of that rehabilitation was also my articles about Jan Loughborough. Jan Loughborough, historian, ? Even Arthur White said of Jan Loughborough, Elder Loughborough often relied on his memory, and his memory did not serve him well. Again, for your listeners, it was Loughborough who, in his book in 1892, The Rise and Progress of the Seventh-day Adventists, sort of dismissed Foy as a failed prophet and as someone who died shortly after the disappointment. Sure. Had no idea that Foy lived on for many years after that.
He became proud and then he died, you know.
Yeah, became proud and then he died. He even continued his ministry. He was known as a preacher up there in northern Maine. He was a farmer and preacher. So that was a big thrill. And later, I think I actually got up there and personally took pictures of it as well.
And I actually have a letter from a Mormon genealogist in 1982 on Foy. The genealogist did a study on Foy, and it was written to my father and you. So it was addressed to both of you, and this is from 1982.
Yeah,
okay. And so I would assume that when you were at the White Estate that you were kind of, you know, facilitating some of the research and things like that. So,
sure.
Okay. We're almost done. Tell me about this. Why did you do something on the Oakwood strike?
I don't know if I had heard from one of the survivors, you know, or what it was, but I here were these students in 1931 who were fomenting this strike, which eventually led to the first Black president of Oakwood. And they were all expelled. They were all kicked out of school. And they were all told by the white leadership of the union and the folks that were dismissing them that there would be no place for them in the work. Yeah. And yet, except for one who fell away, almost all of them became prominent leaders in the Seventh-day Adventist Church and in the Black Seventh-day Adventist Church. They were early on showing their leadership skills. And by fomenting this strike and working it out, so that was just so fascinating to me. The fascinating part of it was that these young men, who were thrown out of school and assured that they would never succeed, succeeded at the very thing that they had been working on all along.
Oh yeah, very good. And I can send you an article by Holly Fisher. She did some more work. I think that she did her thesis at Howard University on the Oakwood strike. And she, I think that she uses this article. So there's been a little more work on that since then. But
now, did she also cover the other student strikes that were going on during that period of time? Because
no, just Oakwood, I think.
Yeah. But there, I have learned, and I forget who was telling me, but there were others, there were strikes, similar kinds of strikes going on at other black colleges and universities at that time.
Okay, interesting. All right. This is the last slide, because from these books, yeah, we're on the last slide, from well, there's actually one book, The Disappointed, very important. I think that this is one of our earliest Adventist authored books. I think Dr. Numbers was still kind of in the church at the time in 87, at least still affiliated. It was produced by the Indiana University Press, and your article is definitely, I consider it as one of the foundations for the study that I've been doing a lot of lately on Black Millerites. And you were drawing the connection between the Millerite movement and abolitionists. So can you tell us how you became interested in this and how you ended up writing this?
When I discovered that Angelina Grimke had Millerite sympathies, that led me to follow all the other Adventists. And again, it's a matter of contextual. I mean, all of these reforms came together. The health reform, dress reform, abolitionism, the peace movement, Dorothea Dix and reforming mental institutions, all of these things came together. When you found, if you were a vegetarian and you went to a new town and you wanted to get a vegetarian meal, you would go to the abolitionist boarding house. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So all these things work together. Now, let me just say this, that Kevin Burton is working on a PhD in Florida. Florida State. And he is going to greatly advance our understanding of the abolitionist, Millerite, and Adventist connection. He is a very good scholar, and he's getting a lot of good new information that will rejoice to have.
Definitely. And just to say, he's building on this. Like, he's, you know, the first thing he consults is things like this. And of course he has this, and he's citing it because there is a letter in which Miller wrote to, I think, Henry something, I forget his name, but Miller is being ironic in the letter. Yeah. And I think F.D. Nickel or someone concluded that Miller was racist from it, but you show that Miller was being ironic, and really he was saying that slavery was a great evil, whereas before I think it was interpreted as was Miller kind of racist. And so in many ways, this article, it not only showed that the major Millerite leaders like Himes, Elon Galusha, Bates, and others were abolitionist, but it also sort of recast Miller. So,
yeah, you know, again, it's F.D. Nickel was a child of his time, and he knew so little about this time that he completely misread Miller's letter. But, you know, me being a child of the 60s and all of that, I immediately said to myself, how in the world could he have misinterpreted that?
Yeah.
Now, before we go, though, and I know we're over time, but before we go, there are some other books that we mustn't ignore. For instance, the Southern work is now reprinted. You know.
Sure.
But there's also, let me see. Oh yes, here's a couple of things that must not be overlooked.
That's funny. have you seen my new compilation? It's called Councils on Blacks.
No, I haven't seen that.
It's a 1,500 page. I produced it in 2017. It's a 1,500 page PDF on everything that Ellen White wrote about Black people.
Okay, well, send that along if you're willing. Now, there's some other books that we should mention too. This one is good, Ellen White on Social Justice.
Definitely.
And then your father's book, the Lewis Schieff book is very interesting and important, and really amazing that the Pacific Press, official Adventist publication, would publish a book about a minister who was a Seventh-day Adventist and left the faith. You know what I mean?
Yes.
But we have matured in that way, and so. Sure. But tell us just a little about these two. What?
Well, I was coming of age when my dad was working on The Unknown Prophet.
Yeah.
Those were my, I mean, I was born in 79. So he was working on him in the early 80s and then late 80s. And so those were during my formative years.
Yeah.
And I would say that it was from that time that I first developed the passion to do Adventist history and really to become a writer.
Yeah.
And so, of course, you know that my dad did his dissertation on Ellen G. White, the way that she communicated about the Black work.
Yeah.
And then later I would come and do my dissertation also on Ellen White and her relationship with Blacks. You know, both my dad and I both did our dissertation on that. And so these books are some of the fruits of that research. My dad was at Oakwood at the time, and I was noticing the abundance and the robust correspondence of Ellen White on Oakwood.
Yeah.
And so I said, wouldn't it be really good to get a compilation of that for, you know, for people who, for Oakwood students and for administrators to see what she said about that.
Sure.
Because when I was attending Oakwood, there were a lot of legends about what Ellen White said, like never sell an acre of this land and things like that. So I said, let's get them all in one book, everything she said about it. And then People of Providence is just some of her more exceptional and representative statements on Blacks. And so both of those are now available online. And I will send you Councils on Blacks, Doc, because I think you'll appreciate it. It's 1,500 pages, and because it's not a print book, it's not confined for, you know, by space.
Good.
And so it is the full Ellen White letter or article. And so the reader can see it in its full context, since it's a PDF and it's not confined by space.
Okay.
So, but thank you so much, Dr. Graybill, for your time today, but also your historiography, your writing, your research. Like I said, I can't say enough about what you have done for my own historiography and others like Kevin Burton, others who have come behind of this generation and generations before. Your works are highly cited. They are plentifully acknowledged. And so I just want to pay homage to you and your work.
Okay, thank you so much. We'll say goodbye now to the Lintonia School and the students all gathered around. And boy, oh boy, wasn't it popular to wear a hat in those days.
Thank you so much, Doc.
Okay, bye for now.